Indra Devi, the daughter of European nobility who introduced the ancient discipline of yoga to the Kremlin leadership, Hollywood stars like Gloria Swanson, and even students in India, died on Thursday in Buenos Aires. She was 102. And so it described this life. She was born in 1899, and it described this life that kind of completely tracks so many of the most fascinating events of the 20th century. So she's born in Latvia when it's still a part of the Russian Empire. She flees the Russian Revolution. She becomes a cabaret performer in Weimar Berlin. She gets involved in theosophy, which is to me, a fascinating movement that was the kind of precursor of a lot of modern New Age movements. She follows a guru, Krishnamurti, to India. She becomes, she kind of hangs around on the fringes of the Indian nationalist movement. She has this flirtation with Nehru. I should say not all of this is actually in the New York Times obituary, but from there she learns India, she learns yoga as it's sort of being recreated by the Indian nationalist movement. She's in Shanghai, she's in Vietnam, she shows up in Panama during a kind of very crucial episode in the history of Latin America. She spends the end of her life in Buenos Aires. It was just a sort of fascinating story. And the story itself is actually, you know, even wilder than I had kind of realized at the time. There was parts of it that were not in the New York Times obituary, or that had not been previously covered by anyone until I was able to get a hold of her CIA file, her FBI file, and, you know, find out about her, the lover that she had in Shanghai, the very, very interesting role that she had in the overthrow of Noriega. You know, she was this sort of, as I write in the book, she was this sort of zealot figure who just sort of pops up at all of these very kind of colorful, pivotal moments of U.S. history. But also, by tracing her story, I think I was able to answer, at least for myself, the question that I had set out to answer, which was, what is this thing that we're doing under the name of yoga, and where does it really come from? So the book that first awakened her to yoga and that first made her excited about yoga was this book called 14 Lessons in Oriental Philosophy and Yogi Occultism by someone named Yogi Ramacharaka. And she found it in the library of one of her mother's Bohemian friends in Silver Age Russia and was enchanted with it. And it made her say, you know, I must go to India. And what she didn't know and had no way of knowing is that Yogi Ramacharaka was a Chicago business writer named William Walter Atkinson. What we now know as yoga was a man named Krishnamacharya, who was in residence at the Mysore Palace when Indra Devi when Indra Devi was invited to this huge opulent wedding there. And I promise that I'll run away with you. I'll run away with you. She wanted to study with him. She, you know, kind of went to him. She asked him. He said, absolutely not. There's no way I'm teaching, you know, a woman and a Westerner. But she, one of the things about Indra Devi that we can talk about is that she had this almost supernatural level of charisma, right? She sort of drifts through life even though she lost everything, even though her family, you know, her family had been wealthy and they lost everything in the revolution, but she never lost her sort of social capital and her sense of entitlement, which I don't mean in a bad way at all, but I just mean because she believed that she belonged in kind of all, you know, rarefied circumstances, other people did as well. And so wherever she went, people sort of wanted to take care of her and wanted to do things for her. And so she's friends with the Maharaja. The Maharaja tells Krishnamacharya, she's my friend, my guest, and you have to teach her. And so eventually he imparts this system of yoga that he was developing. His other kind of most influential students, for those of you who do yoga, were his brother-in-law, BKS Iyengar, and Pattabhi Joyce, who created Ashtanga Yoga.
And so I came first just to present myself and ask permission. He had only men and only boys and only Indians in the school. At that time, I was a head like this and, you know, came to the yoga.
So he took her on, and he was extremely hard on her. He was hoping, essentially, that he would drive her to quit, and she didn't. She showed up early, she stayed late, she worked so hard, she did everything that was asked of her and more, and she became one of his best, most dedicated, most passionate, disciplined students. From there, he actually granted her the ability to teach yoga. Lost and lonely you, just like soft and only you, lost and lonely you.
You know, just a lot of, if we're saying kind of what is this thing called yoga and where does it come from, the answer is that it comes from Krishnamacharya at the Mysore Palace. And which is not to say, of course, that the part of the tricky thing in talking about yoga and where it comes from is that yoga is such a labial word. There is a Sanskrit scholar named David Gordon White, who described it as the word with the most translations of any word in the Sanskrit lexicon. If you say, yes, people have been doing yoga for 3,000 years, more than that, maybe, that's certainly true. And so the yoga that we have today in the West, you know, of course, is going to look, you know, it's filling an entirely different social function. Of course, it's going to look very different than anything that was done by, you know, Indian ascetics on the banks of the Ganges 1,000 years ago. And the person, again, who translated these practices developed by first Indian ascetics, then by Indian nationalists, and made it really a self-help regimen for cosmopolitan Western woman was Indra Devi. She was married to a Czech diplomat, and after she learns yoga from Krishnamacharya at the Mysore Palace, she goes with her husband. He's transferred to represent the government in Shanghai. Shanghai at the time is an international city. It's divided between the British, the French, and the Chinese, and you don't need a passport to get in. In the FBI file, it mentions that the reason that the FBI got onto her in the first place is because this woman walked into an embassy in Shanghai and accused her of being a communist spy. And then people that they interview think that, well, the reason that this woman did this is because she's having an affair with the woman's husband. And that was the first thing I learned of that. But then I kind of found out that this man she was having an affair with, Abraham Avshalomov, was himself a very well-known composer whose son had self-published all of his letters from World War II and afterwards.
And I'm just curious as to how she was regarded in India, and whether this was a source of pride to Indians, or whether they felt that, you know, this was something that, you know, some crazy Westerner was doing.
No, she was actually very, very respected in India. And again, part of this is because of who her teachers in India had been. And like I said, she had this relationship, you know, this flirtation with Jawaharlal Nehru. She was friends with his daughter, you know, Indira Gandhi. She met Gandhi. She, you know, kind of always gave all of the credit for what she was teaching to her Indian teachers. And so Indra Devi's first book was actually published in India in 1948, immediately after she had left Shanghai. And she was there for a little while right before she decamped to Los Angeles. And she would all, you know, every time she went back, she would go and visit various, she had lots of friends who were Maharajas and Maharanis. She would go and visit Indira Gandhi, and there would always be these kind of admiring write-ups in the local Indian press. She comes to the U.S. in 1947. It's also at a time when there is, you know, a lot of kind of fascination with Eastern religious practices. And through a whole series of events, she reconnects with a woman who is maybe romantically involved with Greta Garbo, who becomes one of her earliest students. Like you said, Gloria Swanson, kind of fresh off Sunset Boulevard, becomes her student and her very close friend, and kind of had a big role in popularizing both her and yoga. You know, and of course, Hollywood, you know, again, I keep going back to the title of her first book, which was actually, Gloria Swanson gave her the name, Forever Young, Forever Healthy, right? I mean, it's hard to think of a title with more resonance in Hollywood.
I'll run away with you. When I first time saw Baba, and this was in 1966, one of his devotees told me so many stories about his miracles, but there is one which I always was longing to see, because I saw everything. But she said about him gathering thick sand on the river and then just making a little drawing and taking out the thing he was drawing. This I've never seen before. All the miracles of Baba, or as he calls them, Leelas, which means plays, divine plays, are nothing in comparison to a real miracle, which is completely changing a person, no matter how cynical, how unbelieving, how hard-boiled he or she may be.
And Indra Devi brought me to meet him, and she had raised money for an orphanage. And so there was a rope with about six chairs, and then outside the rope were as many people as you could see, like hundreds, maybe a thousand. And I was sitting next to a four-star general with a neck brace on. So Satya Sai Baba came out and was introduced to me, and then he turned to this man. He lit his shirt up like this, known as a kurta. And so we could see there was nothing on his arm. He put his fingers down and shot holy ashes called vibhuti into this man's hand. He put it on his tongue and his forehead, and then he took the neck brace off and went like this, and he was healed. It was amazing.
Mataji, ¿usted no tiene un anillo materializado por Sai Baba?
¿Cómo?
El anillo.
Ese es un anillo materializado,
sí,
por Sai Baba.
Sí. ¿Qué significa? Es, además, él me materializó.
Creado, corporizado.
No,
yo,
él
yo,
materializó
yo lo he visto
un otro anillo, como siempre materializó. Sí. El anillo que él me materializó no me gustó, porque no pongo ninguna joya desde que estoy dando clase de yoga, aunque pueda. Y yo pensé en mi cuarto, este anillo no me gusta, no puedo ponerlo. El día siguiente él me llama, otras personas, dice, regresa el anillo, achanei, no es bien. Tomó el anillo, sopló y me regresó. Y dijo, ¿usted quiso con mi retrato? Dije, sí. Cada vez cuando usted quiera puede verme el anillo, ninguna
pero
otra
persona. Pero qué extraordinario, por Dios.
Pero cual. Yo dije, yo no pongo joyas. Dije, no es joya, es para su protección. Yo regreso en la casa y me dice, Mataji, usted con un diamante.
Esto es un regalo.
Ay, gracias.
Son estas ML, perdón, continúe contando.
No es diamante, es para mi protección.
Is there something else you're searching for?
ಇದೊಂದು ಪುಸ್ತಕ the book about you, and here is my father's own handwriting here. On Narayana. Namami Narayana Pada Pankajam Karomi Narayana Pujanam Sada Vadami Narayana Namanam Malam Smarami Narayana Tattvamam Yajam.
Oh, wonderful. And he'll do it with me, the Asatoma, you know. Asatoma Sadamaya Tamasoma Jyotigamaya Mrityorma Amritangamaya Aum Shanti Shanti.
Ile, idhara van charitre, Asatoma sonna patiya, eppadi sonna, beautiful. He is going to show you some extraordinary photographs.
They are there.
Well, in here, photographs. You have the photograph there?
Yes, yes.
This is, you know what is this? This is the feet of my father's guru. He always... You know that?
And Andres was asking me, who was his guru?
Rama Mohana Brahmachari. Ranganatha Swami, this is the feet of his religious teacher.
Yes, 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 yes.
What I love about about her is her incredibly intrepid spirit and independence, you know, again and again. You know, forget the kind of courage it takes to take off on your own for India in the 20s. Think about the courage it takes to start your life over again when you're almost 50 in Hollywood, in a country where you don't know anyone and a milieu that does not exactly celebrate middle-aged women, you know. And it kind of, it goes on and on and on. She decides to start a new life in Buenos Aires in her 80s because, you know, her husband has died and she's ready to move on. She just, you know, it's inspiring to me as someone whose 40th birthday is coming up and who, you know, feels this sense of dread to see that she didn't even really, you know, for, you know, in a way, kind of her real life didn't even start until she's in her late 30s and her 40s. And her, you know, she kind of never stops having adventures. She never stops recreating herself.
You know, she also didn't have two kids.
Yes, no, she that no, it's true. She, but she is like, you know, her life is kind of a testament to what a lot of us hope to get out of yoga. And so, what I've said a couple of times is that I think she is a testament to yoga's efficacy, but not to its ethics, because she, you know, I think the other side of this incredible lightness that she had and this willingness to kind of skate on the surface of events is that she very much refused to be responsible or bound to other people. And I think part of this was sort of a mistranslation of certain concepts from both Hindu and Buddhist philosophy. She would say that she practiced love and detachment. You know, and detachment is obviously a huge, huge part of both Hinduism and Buddhism, but I think that she translated it to mean kind of that you have no responsibility for other people, and that's not my understanding of how it works classically. So, for example, with her second husband, he has a stroke. He himself was a very revered alternative medicine practitioner and had a lot of people around him who also loved him and wanted to take care of him. She wanted to go to India because she was at the time in the orbit of a very powerful and ultimately pretty sinister guru, and this is in the 1970s. And she wants her husband with her, but she also doesn't really want to take care of him. So she relocates him to India, sets him up at a house outside the ashram, but then sort of leaves him there with some aides that she's hired. And then later on, she starts following another guru and she moves him to Sri Lanka, which is where he died, you know, away from his family, away from everyone who loved him.
We're in Los Angeles, is that right?
Right, yeah. You know, he hated it there. He, you know, couldn't really read to himself anymore. He was, I mean, it was a really sad end to a really kind of a wonderful man. And she doesn't really make any apologies for it. She said, you know, yes, it's true, I wasn't a good wife, but I practice love and detachment. And I believe that, you know, you can never, you know, let kind of the needs of another person knock you off your spiritual path. And I sort of tend to believe that you can judge a spiritual path by how it makes you treat other people. And so, yeah, I mean, you know, and I had some reservations about this when I was writing the book, because on the one hand, I do feel like I had this sort of visceral, the more I learned about how she treated him, the more kind of viscerally negative I felt. At the same time, I thought, you know, how many male religious leaders, spiritual figures have mistreated their family members and kind of, you know, it's at best, you know, a footnote in their biography. So I tried to kind of keep that in mind. At the same time, it doesn't seem like it's something that's particularly forgivable to me.
Algo a las mujercitas, acá tenemos muchas mujeres que nos ven. ¿Querrías decirle algo a las mujercitas allá en esa cámara? ¿Te gusta ser mujer?
Voy a decir, yo no quiero ser hombre, estoy muy contenta. Porque yo pienso que mujer tiene es carácter femenino, así, si está para la familia, ¿no? Si una mujer es alcalde, toda para la ciudad. Si usted presidente o primer ministro, todo para el país. Es característica femenina.
Dar.
Dar y proteger.
Qué lindo. Dar y proteger. Volvemos en un momentito a hacer una oración en ese altar de todas las religiones, ¿sí? Ya volvemos.
Con todo gusto.
Sí, porque ella nos quiere y nosotros la queremos mucho. Mira cómo el estudio está tan armonioso, tan amoroso. Mira, mira cómo está el estudio. Qué lindo.
Muy lindo. Y cuando voy a bajar, da un beso a cada uno.
Vamos.
Just reached a place where the willow don't bend. Not much more to be said. It's the top of the end. I'm gone. I'm closing the book on the pages and the text, and I don't really care what happens next. I'm going.
Gracias, madre, por tanto amor, por ser tan generosa.
I've been hanging on threads. I've been playing it straight. I just gotta cut loose before it gets too late. So I'm gone. Grandma said, boy, go and follow your heart. Shine, don't you and your one true love ever part. I've been walking the road, I've been living on the edge. Now I just gotta go before I get to the ledge. So I'm gone.
Now, before we start to meditate, I would like first to read a few sentences about meditation by the famous Cardinal Mercier. He says, "I am going to reveal to you a secret of sanctity and happiness. If every day, during 5 minutes, you will keep your imagination quiet, shut your eyes to all the things of sense, and close your ears to all the sounds of earth, so as to be able to withdraw into the sanctuary of your soul, which is the temple of the Holy Spirit, your life will pass happily and serenely. Consolation will abound even in the midst of trouble. Grace will be given in proportion to the trial as well as strength to bear it, bringing you to the gates of paradise full of merit." And the meditation he gives is the following: "O Holy Spirit, soul of my soul, I adore thee. Enlighten, guide, strengthen, and console me. Tell me what I ought to do, and command me to do it. I promise to be submissive in everything thou permittest to happen to me. Only show me what is thy will." Meditation is of immense therapeutic value, as it brings poise, detachment, calmness, emotional maturity, and spiritual reward to minds forced into acceptance of organized distraction, which is the everyday routine of any Western metropolitan existence. Meditation raises the moral standard of the individual. It helps the young to build an ideal and to form a character. It gives a higher reason for living, takes away the drudgery of life for those engaged in struggle for existence, and it does away with fear. The effectiveness of meditation does not depend upon any further knowledge, but only upon the effectiveness of action that follows. Correctly understood, this is action without conscious action, purposefulness without stressed purpose, virtue without any attempt towards virtue. It is natural being. It is everyday life lived fully and richly. Through meditation, you may learn to change the direction of your thinking, of your mind, of your desire. Meditation is the looking glass for your spiritual face, to see into all parts of the mind. A man suffers because he desires to retain what cannot be retained. Meditation leads to illumination of the spirit, the liberation of the inside, and a consequent emancipation from the fetters of daily existence.